Gentlemen, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the coffee break and are feeling suitably reinvigorated, and that you caught up with a few old friends and no doubt met some new ones too. And we have a very old friend of the funds industry, I hope that you don't mind me saying, Furio, and for our next keynote interview, when we look at the outlook for the European funds industry, I'd like to introduce one of the highest profile and most knowledgeable characters in the European investment industry, who built the first part of his career in his native Italy before recreating his success in Dublin, of course, our friendly rival centre. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce the CEO of Mediolanum International Funds, Mr. Furio Pietribiasi.
Thank you, Yuri.
Furio, you don't mind if we look back in time before we look forward? If I can take you back 35 years, because that was the theme of the minister's speech this morning. 35 years of the European funds industry from when the UCITS directive came in, when you and I were much younger, we didn't have these grey hairs, the 1980s, when we had the shoulder pads, they were still regularly inserted in your favourite double-breasted Italian suit, which you're sporting very well today. When the late-night venues we frequented, they were perfumed with that delicate mix of hairspray and cigarette smoke, I think was the odour of the day. The football world was populated by the artists such as Maradona, Marco van Basten, Jorgi Hagi, who you remember well. How, in those days, if you can, just to get you back in the mood of that time, how important was the EU UCITS directive of 1988 when sowing the seeds of the European funds industry?
Well, I believe that everything started from there, and particularly the innovation, the real competition. Because if we think about our industry before the first UCITS regulation, was very insular, so every country was doing its own thing. Clearly there were countries like UK that were much ahead than others because they have a much longer history in the asset management industry, obviously US. But again, it was very challenging as well from the Americans to come into continental Europe and to be able to bring the same innovation, the same strategies that they were running in the US, because there wasn't the ecosystem, there wasn't the environment, and clearly there were regulators, they were more advanced than others. And with the first UCITS, when centers like Luxembourg before and then Ireland after, you know, and of course London, they've been able to passport their own products into the continental Europe, and they have created the right ecosystem for the development of our industry, which was not looking inwards, but looking outwards. And that is an important topic for where we are going forward and the concern that they have for the future, but staying for the past. You know, that was exactly the sparkle that initiated our industry, I would say, and the blossom of our industry, because then we've seen more players like ourselves that were operating in an ecosystem that wasn't as advanced as others, you know, and we moved at that time to Ireland, and we were enabled to start competing with these big players. Not because we had the same knowledge and the same experience, but we could start a learning process by using the same consultant, by using the same providers, and so on, and by using delegation, which is a fundamental element of for success, for innovation, and to deliver quality to our investors. So all of that has been creating what is our industry today, and the competition, because again, yes, we had we have funds here in Luxembourg, we have funds in Ireland, we have funds in Spain, we had funds in Italy, and in our main Manco asset management platform is in Ireland, but I'm always pushing for having more centers, more competitive centers. So I'm happy and I will always be supportive to Luxembourg and the success of Luxembourg, because competition brings quality.
Was there a strategic vision, Furio, to develop that investment infrastructure and expertise we now very much enjoy in Dublin and here in Luxembourg? Or was there just a directive around which a nebulous system was allowed to emerge?
Well, I think there was a lot of planning. I don't think that was just a serendipity moment and things just happened. I think there was a lot of planning, a lot of work, a lot of coordination through different governments here in Luxembourg, in Ireland, to make sure that things were happening. Investments in the entire ecosystem. You know, Luxembourg has an ecosystem. Ireland has an ecosystem. UK, of course, has an ecosystem. Unfortunately, it's not anymore part of the EU, but and it will be much missed. But, you know, they were ecosystem. They didn't just happen. There was a lot of work in identifying the right training, the right courses at university, to create the right regulatory framework, the right processes. You know, that's very important. And more important than anything, collaboration. Collaboration between regulators and collaboration with private sectors, collaboration with the departments. And when I'm talking about collaboration with regulators, that doesn't mean lowering the bar for regulations, because actually it didn't happen. If only has only been increased and the pressure from regulators. But that's not the point. The point is having the dialogue, having the access, and working together and trying to figure it out, you know, what is the best way to deal with the issue. So new regulation coming in, what are the expectations of the regulators, how we can deal with that. If you have a dialogue, you will always find a solution. So a lot of planning, a lot of hard work.
And on that topic of regulation, and I know that you're often quoted on these issues as an expert commentator. Many of you read the Ignite news service published by the FT, and you're often quoted in there, as you were this morning, Furio. The LTIF rules, and there's been a lot of talk about them now, designed to channel retail money into private market assets. Your view of these LTIF rules, are they correct? Are they necessary? Bearing in mind that there are many other structures already available for these purposes.
Look, LTIF was something that was established in parallel with the European Capital Market Units and the planning. They were meant to go hand in hand. The problem is the European Capital Markets Union didn't go anywhere. Seems to be the priority for the new parliament. But, and LTIF, you know, had some momentum, but he didn't get the support on the other side. So probably it hasn't been seen as instrumental as, you know, it would have been if European Capital Markets Union momentum was stronger. And as a result, is one of those things where there isn't enough conviction, there isn't probably enough collaboration discussions, and there is the will is not necessarily there to bypass and to figure it out how it needs to be structured and how it should happen. Because I think there is it's missing the leg of the European Capital Markets Union, politically speaking, I'm saying. And on the other side, like you pointed out, it's not the only way to deliver you know, private assets into the retail space. You know, each country has its own way to give access to this product. Clearly, it would be a big advantage for us as managers to have one solution can be cross-border. It would be more cost-efficient as well for the investors. And it would be great to be able to build another platform like this. But again, you know, I think we'll be soon sorted if the European Capital Markets Union is going to get a new energy, and we'll see things happening there.
It's very interesting, Furio, that you bring in this political dimension, and I'm curious to explore your view of the relationship between business and politics. Mr. Ennio Doris, your old boss and founder of Mediolanum, visionary character. He was very close indeed to the levers of power, with Silvio Berlusconi having been his original investor. And you yourself, if you don't mind me saying, you've moved very adeptly through the Irish inner political circle at your firm's Dublin base. Is it vital to have this close relationship? After all, it's a relationship the likes of the Brexit-obsessed Conservative Party in the UK has neglected for far too long.
Well, politics is very important to understand how politicians think and what concerns politicians. And you need to listen to all of them to try to understand what is the direction of travel, how they see things. And if you can, if you allow, you know, to give your input and to give your angle, to give your perspective, to help them to have more information, to be able to have taken much more educated decision. Our industry is very complicated, you know, and a lot of the things that we have to deal with is linked to misconceptions or misunderstanding about our industry. And because, as I said, it's very complex. Going back to the point of the distribution, it's very complex. Distribution is very different in the different countries. There are different players and there are different models. And sometimes, you know, we see it only one line, you know, and we don't see the nuances around it. And that's one challenge. So that's our role, to engage with politicians and try to help them to understand a little bit better. Obviously today is key and it will be key. We have the election now in June for the parliament. It's going to be key for all of us, particularly for Luxembourg, Ireland, and many other places, to make sure that we are able to be well represented, our industry be properly represented in terms of the value that we generate for the European economy, which is an economy that needs to be looking outside, not an economy that needs to look inside. The success of financial services in the UK was to be international, wasn't to be local. The success for Europe is to be international, is not to be local Europe. So we need to keep that culture if we want to be competitive. We have the Draghi competitive assessment. Now there is the later assessment at the EU level. So we need to stay competitive. To be competitive, we need to look at globally. So the political engagement is instrumental to help and educate on the complicated matters that we have to deal every day.
And the charismatic Mr. Ennio Doris, whom we mentioned, the founder of Mediolanum, very close to the Italian political system. I know you've been promoting the recently released film about the life of Mr. Doris. One of the key ideas of Mr. Doris was that he never forgot the client. The Mr. or Mrs. Rossi of the Italian Via or Strada, and he said to all the advisors, remember who is the end client. Do you feel sometimes the distribution obsessed European funds industry, with all of its various layers of linkage, sometimes loses sight of who is the real end client?
Well, this is a very important point, because when we look at Mediolanum and we look at what Ennio Doris has been built, because obviously now he passed away 2 years ago, but his son has been taken over as a CEO since 2008. So long time. Of course, it was our chairman Ennio, but Massimo has been leading the business to what is today for now a number of years. But certainly the footprint and the values and the principle, which has become the core pillar of our business, was the client. And our model is designed to maximize the output for our client. And I know that it sounds very basic, because when I'm talking about it, it's a very basic rule. They're very simple. So if you think about our bank, we're providing all services from banking, insurance, asset management, investment banking services, you know. But the key thing is the point of contact is the financial advisor. The financial advisor is a tied agent, but it's commission based. So what does it mean? That if the client is not happy, the financial advisor loses the client, the financial advisor loses remuneration. So actually, you find to have your financial advisors, which we have more than 6,000, that are absolutely focused in getting the best for the client. And they are the most important advocate for the client with us. So yes, we make the products them, they cannot sell anything else. Anything else means our own products or third-party products is irrelevant, you know? But it can only, and this is the challenge, this is the tension, this is the positive tension. You know, so you have your financial advisor, they keep you on your toes, and they want always the best for your client. And Ennio Doris, who was a financial advisor, knew that that was the value, knew that that would have created the right balance for the business. And again, a very simple rule that we always had is the rule of the three yes. So if it's good for the client, if it's good for the bank, and if it's good for the financial advisor, we do it. It's one of the three stakeholders doesn't get any benefits, we don't do it. You know, simple rules. You know, client really has always been at the center of everything we've been doing in terms of being focusing on starting from financial planning. We're not selling products. We start from advising the client, trying to understand their needs, and then from needs, you know, understand their dreams, their objectives. You develop a relationship, and then you figure it out what the solution are. Yeah. So you'll never focus on the product. So simple rules, even at you know, making sure they don't sell when the market goes down, actually helping them to add money when the market goes down. You know, this is the secret. When people are, I'm telling the story, they look at us and they think that is oversimplistic, but that's the reality. You know, and if you focus on the client, you never make a mistake. You know, that's it.
Because if we look at that, talking about when to sell the products. You are famed in the industry for your levels of sales results. At the height of the global financial crisis, 2009, in financial terms, there were blood on the streets. Banks were talking about the end of capitalism. Is it on the brink of collapse? People forget how serious the situation was. In that year, you managed to sell, your team sold 6 billion euros worth of multi-manager products. For you, is the crisis a better time than a benign period for a fund manager to really thrive?
Actually, it is. I know that it sounds silly, but I love when crises are coming, because every time that we have a big crisis, we gain market share. Every time. And you know, and the reason being very simple again, because we are there with our client. Number one, we have already explained to our clients that volatility happens. But number two, we tell them the volatility is their friends. Volatility is your friend to make money. When the markets are going down, is the time to buy. You know, and momentum clearly is very difficult. So you need to always continue to buy over the time. So diversifying over the time. But when the market goes down and there are big drops, is the time to invest even more. So the clients are already psychologically prepared. They see the mechanism and the value of dollar averaging cost. And we built also automated services in our products that allow to maximize that. So when the time comes and our financial advisor meets the client, you know, the client is ready, you know, and the client invests. So if you look at our flows, when the market goes down, they always go higher. You know, and this is the time where our competitors, they don't go and meet clients because they're worried. You know, they don't know how to address it. Or, that's very important, you know. Or when they are there, they don't advise the client saying, look, you know, invest. What they're saying, okay, oh, let's take the money. It's more volatility, let's take the risk off. But in the long term, this won't pay, because the financial advisor role is not portfolio manager role. This is what the portfolio manager does. The portfolio manager thinks on a daily basis, you know, on a monthly basis, on a quarterly basis, but vis-a-vis in terms of time horizon. But retail investors, which obviously is our core market, is the long term. So that's what makes a difference.
I think that relationship between the management, the center, and the advisors doing the rounds of the clients is absolutely key, as you're pointing out, Furio. And Mr. Doris, he was very well known for the mass meetings with advisors he would set up in the Italian countryside over village food and the presidential speeches he made on his own TV channel. Now, this kind of brand and leader loyalty, is that a thing of the past? Because at the moment, we've got a lot of leaders who are just following the latest trends, who don't want to disrupt the status quo. Do we have room in this industry for this kind of charismatic leader, visionary, self-styled, prepared to break the mold, to go against the grain?
Hey, this is a, you know, it's a very difficult question, because well, if we think about you know, what Ennio was, a man of incredible vision, you know, but he was a man that has adapted as well with the times. Today, clearly, it becomes a little bit more challenging because institutions are getting bigger and bigger. Regulation, they're adding different layer of complexity. So sometimes it's difficult today probably to being able to implement such a visionary approach like Ennio did in the 80s and brought it forward to make Mediolanum what is today, a bank with over 1.8 million clients and almost 130 billion assets. So, but again, in our little world, that not necessarily we need people like that today. We need just people that have a much longer term view. You know, my concern today is not to have incredible one out of 10,000 entrepreneurs that is able to build something so unique. Is being able to have an industry that looks over the next quarter, over the next year, because the way that this industry, our industry, but financial services, the way the remuneration works, the way that companies are managed, the way that the companies change the management, they do not allow them to have a very long-term vision. And that's, to me, the challenge. Because even in the little things, because I cannot compare myself absolutely, not even just a little finger of Ennio Doris, but something that I always thank him and his son today in the last number of years, the organization, is having the ability to implement strategy for the long run and trying to think also longer, you know, to have a vision on things. Because sometimes you are not allowed by your board and by your management to have a vision above the deliverables of the next 3 months or deliverables of the year. If you start thinking about the next 5 years, it's, no, sorry. Get me the budget. This is not your job.
To be fair, Fury, that's one of the reasons Ennio Doris picked you to run the asset management operation, because he saw that you had that innovative streak in you. And one of the things you did, you broke the mold. You moved the investment team from Milan to Dublin to join Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, Amazon, all the tech entrepreneurs. There's been a lot of talk amongst other fund management companies of moving the investment staff to Dublin, to Luxembourg, but very few have done that. What have been the benefits of that? Are you expecting a greater influx of investment talent to these hubs to complement the back office business which we see in the room here today?
Well, let me put it this way. I was allowed and supported by an organization, by certainly Ennio, Massimo, again, his son, and management to deliver what Mediolan has been delivering in Ireland, and all my team has been able to deliver in Ireland. Having said that, in terms of growth, yes, it's a challenge, you know, because there was a higher risk to fail than to succeed. Let's be brutally honest. Because on these things, you can only do, going back to the culture of the organization, an organization that is willing to take a business risk, an organization that accept visions, an organization that has long-term horizon. So technically, you know, and there's been a long journey because we made as well mistakes, just to be very clear, because we had times that things haven't done as we would have liked. But technically, it was the higher risk is of failure rather than of success. So, you know, I think that that's the reason why a lot of organizations are resistant in embracing certain things. Nobody wants to fail, and there is no tolerance for failure, and it's too personal, risky, too risky for organization, too risky for management. That said, in terms of future, I believe that in the future, we will see the opportunity to grow more and more front office people, more people on the product side, and already is happening because with distribution oversight, it requires more and more and better skills. So it's not any more ghosting stuff that is already happening in UK or in US. So it's actually stuff that is happening in developing here in Lux or in Ireland, and I think it can happen also in the asset management. It's obvious that we need to see how that happens. You know, I would be disappointed to see that happening because we are in a situation where delegation, because it's one of the things delegation, I still hear in Brussels, there are some debates to limit delegation and the ability to delegate outside the Eurozone. That would be very disappointing because it wouldn't be good for our clients. Certainly would allow to have more people probably being allocated in jurisdiction like Ireland and Luxembourg. Maybe we won't have the same level of skills and competencies initially, and probably we won't have the same level of independence. But certainly that will be accelerating the front office people. But again, it's a conflicting sentiment because one side, you see that there is a big opportunity to a certain extent, but on the other side, when you think about your clients, you know that it's the wrong thing. Because if delegation would be limited in any way, this is going to be a serious problem for the final investors in terms of innovation, in terms of quality, in terms of choices. So it would be nicer to see Luxembourg, Ireland, and other jurisdictions, you know, developing into the front office, which is going to happen anyway, without being forced and without doing things that could result in somewhat suboptimal than what happens in UK or US.
Well, I think that's what management's all about, ladies and gentlemen, managing these conflicting sentiments. And Furio is somebody who's done that very successfully over the last three decades. And he's talked about regulation, he's talking about the past trends and the vision of the future. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for our interviewee.